Thank you very much. Welcome to this presentation in which I have the honor to present some first results and first insights from an ongoing project where we still have a lot of scope of things to discover, but where it's nonetheless interesting to already be able to discuss first results with the community that knows the GramBank data very well. So this is an ongoing project with a lot of collaborators from the University of Zurich, where I am based. And some of the Max Planck team here from the core GramBank team. So thank you very much to the collaborators as well. Of course, this work is also very much theirs. So in this talk, I want to first motivate why we have selected a specific algorithm that was designed to detect contact areas in local case studies for a global analysis with the possibility to do so with the large scope of GramBank. Then how we have needed to curate the GramBank data so that it actually ends up aligning as best as possible, or at least better, with the model assumptions that SBayes takes. And in the end, I can provide some first insights from our first runs of SBayes with GramBank on a global scale. So beginning with the model SBayes. SBayes is a Bayesian mixture model that some of you probably know because it's already been mentioned in at least one talk today. It's a mixture model run in Python that was proposed in 2021 by colleagues of mine from the University of Zurich. This is Peter, Nico, and Balthazar. And they proposed a clustering model that accounts for confounding factors in the form of universal dependencies and inheritance in proposing clusters where features, where languages are proposed to represent an area based on similarities of their grammatical features. In a bit more specific detail, SBayes is a hierarchical clustering model that models the probability that a language has a specific state, so for instance, yellow for a specific feature, as a weighted sum of probabilities. And these probabilities are first that this feature state derives from a universal preference over the global distribution of a feature. So if the yellow state of a feature is globally very common, then it is quite likely that a language would have feature state yellow, and we wouldn't be thinking that it being yellow with alongside other languages in a geographical cluster, that this would mainly be explained by membership of this cluster. The second confounding factor, or the second probability that is modeled in here, is that the language derived this feature state due to inheritance, given the distribution of the feature in other languages of the same family. And the proxy for families here are just the glottolog families, just which highest level clade this language belongs to. And the third probability is that the feature state can be explained by the features distribution within a more or less geographically cohesive group that the language is assigned to, if it is currently assigned to one, because the language is not necessarily assigned to a cluster in SBayes. This probability is computed given the feature distribution within this cluster. There are two important things that I want to mention before we get into more. One problem of this model, or one limitation, is that there are no interaction terms that are included in the definition of the model. So if, for instance, a correlation of features is different in an area or in a family, this will be signal that SBayes cannot detect. It's just something that we have to bear in mind. And the second point is that while the model was designed in the hope that whatever comes out as a cluster would be a contact area, we can actually not be sure that this is always the case. So on the one hand, clusters generated by SBayes, and in this plot, these would be the orange, green, and purple areas, or clusters. In the ideal scenario, these clusters would be cases of true contact areas generating these clusters. But we have some experience with applications of space, and we've seen that this is not always the case. So in the middle here, you see a plot of space run on languages from the ancient Near East. And the cluster that emerges from running space on this data is one that connects Hurrian with Sumerian. And if you paid attention in the last talk, these are languages that were not spoken at the same time. So it's impossible that it's actually contact between these languages that is leading to this cluster. And a possible interpretation is that these two languages display some common distribution of some ancient typological distribution, and that the other languages in the sample did not belong to this distribution. And a third possibility, and this is already a glimpse ahead, because this is an output of a space run with GramBank data, would be that the algorithmic constellation or configuration that essentially forces a specific number of clusters to emerge might lump together instances of independent evolution of common typological profiles into what looks like a contact area. So for instance, the brown cluster that is linking Southeast Asian languages with African languages from outside knowledge, independent knowledge, external to linguistics, we would not really believe that this is a contact area, but rather a common a common typological profile displayed that gets forced into a cluster here. So the bottom line of this is that space is a very powerful tool, and we still think that it has a value to be used on a large scale analysis, but we have to be aware of its limitations, and we can't just interpret output as evidence for contact areas without further thinking. How does it work in practical terms? So you feed space a language feature matrix plus language coordinates. You specify a number of priors, also about how what beliefs you have about the geographical model constraining contact areas or clusters. You specify the number of clusters or areas that you want a run to find, and then it computes for a very long time with global data. And in the end, ideally, runs converge, and you can retrieve weights of contributions per feature, the identity of the clusters, and distributions of features within clusters and families. And ideally, you would run space for several iterations with different numbers of clusters, because you wouldn't necessarily know which the optimal number of clusters is, and then use model comparison to identify the ideal number of clusters. And as you saw in the slide before, there have already been some test cases for GramBank. For instance, this test case that was published alongside the algorithm, where an analysis was run on a section of South America. But what has not been conducted so far is an analysis at a global scale. And this is what we are aiming to do here. In an exploratory analysis, we want to move away from such local case studies to see what emerges from a run using data from as many languages and families as possible, without specifically selecting features that might maximize or minimize specific suspected aerial signals for certain regions of the world, and evaluate whether what comes out in any way matches ideas or postulations of areas from the literature. So this is what we're setting out to do. And we are using two independent global data sets to do this, one of them being GramBank, and the second one being a curated data set where we lump variables in a motivated way from Wald's, Feubel, Autotype, and Lexibank. So we also include features on phonology and colexifications with the second database. It sounds, well, you would think you don't have a language feature matrix, and then you can just feed it into the algorithm and see what comes out of it, but it's not as easy as that. Because we want to be sure that the data that we feed into this algorithm match the model assumptions of space as best as possible. And a crucial assumption of space and of other models as well, but in space this is also the case, is that the features used in the analysis should be independent of one another, which includes logical dependence and those forms of statistical dependence that are not modeled in the algorithm. So in this case, forms of statistical dependence that are not aerial, which is what we are trying to discover, or inheritance. So dependencies of functional form between variables would be something worrisome for our analysis, because this kind of signal could be read as aerial signal and conturb the output and the interpretability of it. So this is why we have set out to curate the Gram Bank data, which, as you know, the original data set encompasses 195 features in over 2,400 languages. And we did this in two steps. And in both of them, there are arguably decisions that we made that others might have made differently, but it was just our attempt at doing this as best as we could. So in the first curation step, we sought to identify logical dependencies and try to remove them from the data set as best as we could. So to give an example that actually relates to one of the previous talks earlier today, you know that Gram Bank largely has binary data that let me explain it like this. For nominal gender or noun class systems, Gram Bank contains 12 features. And these 12 features get asked for all languages, including those half of the languages that we saw in the earlier data set and which we also see in Gram Bank that lack gender or noun classes in the first place. And for ESPEs, this is worrisome because the 1,133 languages lacking gender will be grouped together across 12 features and thus get the chance to be more similar to one another more often than languages that do have gender, which we could think of as actually being more similar to one another. One could argue about this and have a different opinion about this, but if we take this perspective, we have a dependency that languages lacking gender get boosted in a way in an analysis that doesn't account for this. So what we did in the case of gender and in some other instances as well, was to create this new meta variable that approximates the presence or absence of gender in this case by aggregating data from these 12 variables and then conditioning the contributing original variables on the positive state of this meta variable. So for instance, variable 51, which is whether there is a gender system where sex is a factor in class assignment, this would become a new question, 51 conditioned, is there a gender or noun class system where sex is a factor in class assignment, if there is a gender or noun class system at all. So those 1,100 languages lacking gender would be assigned a new state not applicable. The languages with a positive state would remain in the positive state, and those languages that do have gender but not a sex-based gender system would be in the negative state of this feature, and the same for the other features and also in other instances independent from gender. So the result of this set of modifications were that we kept 93 original Gram Bank variables and we created 109 Gram Bank variables that were modified due to considerations like these. And in the second step, we sought to find a solution to the problem of statistical dependence. And we've heard many ways to approach this today. And we also came up with one. And I will briefly present to you how we proceeded. So we formulated sets of expectations that were linguistically motivated, either from the literature or also from simply, linguistically informed reasoning about certain Gram Bank features that have not been reflected in the literature because they are very specific. We assessed how strongly these expectations applied to the Gram Bank data over 500 random diversity samples that were genetically diverse and aerially balanced, and then acted on those dependencies that had a very strong effect size and also a very small number of languages deviating from the expectation in general. So let me give an example for this. A universal proposed by Greenberg was that languages with SOV word order usually have postpositions, and translating this into the gram bank variable universe, you could formulate this as if languages have can have verb final word order, then they should also have postpositions. And if we cross-tabulate these variables, we see that this tendency definitely is true, because there are few languages lacking postpositions but having verb final word order, and many that have both. If we evaluate this over these 500 diversity samples, we can then generate a distribution of probabilities, the red probability here being the conditional probability to lack postpositions if you do have verb final word order, and blue being the distribution of probabilities of the marginal probability of lacking postpositions generally. And if you compute Cohen's D and look at the map, at the plot, you can see that the effect size is really big. So having or lacking verb final word order really changes your probability of lacking postpositions. And also the proportion of languages in the red state are very small. It's under 10%. So this would be a dependency that we feel is really strong and that we would worry about for ESPEs, and that we would want to act on. Concretely, we would then remove the original gram bank variable on verb final word order and create a new variable that reads as can you have verb final word order if you have postpositions, with those languages lacking postpositions in the not applicable state. So doing this yielded a net decrease in variables, where we have 39 completely new variables, 86 that we inherit from curation A, and 69 unmodified original variables. With all of this, we are ready to compute, to launch first runs in SPACE, which we do for curations A and B across multiple cluster numbers in multiple replicates to ensure that whatever we see is really a stable result. And while we have only started doing this and cannot present any final results or converged runs yet, what I can show you are some patterns that have been more or less stable across what we have seen so far. So to the top, you see a more or less typical plot of k equals 5 areas, and to the bottom of k equals 10 areas. These runs both have not converged, and they are still running. So we are also not sure that these patterns don't change within 2 weeks from now. The results might look a bit different. That's a caveat. But downloading the data on Monday yielded fairly consistent patterns at k equals 5 and 10 that I want to point out to. So first of all, the previously brown and now purple cluster that you see in k equals 5 is really consistent, linking Southeast Asia and Africa. Not that this means that this is a contact area, but this seems to be common typological profiles that get merged together when you postulate that the world should have 5 clusters that explain features aside from inheritance and universal preference. And also the green cluster, linking languages from the Rift Valley with Caucasian and Himalayan languages, and tangled up north into Eurasia and south into India. That's also another kind of common cluster that we see across many runs for k equals 5. And at k equals 10, we usually see that the Southeast Asian cluster that has a link to Africa still in this specific map, it kind of gets more split into two. So we don't have the full tangle into Africa connected with the Southeast Asian plot. There are other plots where Southeast Asia is already completely separate from Africa at k equals 10. And another pattern is that Northern Australia appears as a cluster, which you can't see very well here on the plot, but the color in Northern Australia is actually distinct from the one in Papua New Guinea. An interesting finding, which, well, will be interesting to see if it consolidates is that in curation B, which is the one that controls for the statistical dependencies, the Northern Australian map emerges fastest, earliest, and most stably, as far as we can tell so far. We, of course, still have some features of these runs that we want to optimize. One of them being that the runs still take very long and we don't have convergence within or across runs yet. So in new runs that we launch, we would subsample the input further so we have less languages in the sample, hoping that that will speed up the runs and also reduce signal from large clades within large families that appear at higher k's, which we want to avoid. And another thing is that if we reduce the rates in the geographical prior, at the moment we have a geographical prior that at 300 kilometers distance, languages have a prior probability of 50% of being in the same cluster. And the exponential decay rate is at 600 kilometers after 300 kilometers. And if we reduce that, we can hopefully punish the generation of very long edges across continents more strongly, such that we would only see these if the signal really, really is very strong, because otherwise it's hard to interpret this in a meaningful way. So we're very curious to see how this turns out. It is truly an exploratory analysis, but I'm sure that some of you have inputs or questions, so I'm very happy to take them and ask you to stay tuned for the progress of the project.